Thank you. I think they have prepared us for the way of the Lord today on this second Sunday of Advent. Well done, my good and faithful servants. Probably takes you back a few years, doesn't it? Yeah. Well, we are going to hear about preparing the way of the Lord today in the Gospels and in the sermons. But before I get there, I have a number of announcements to make and share with you. The first one is going to be a video of Mark Sanders.
I'm Mark Sanders, and this is One Voice, the music of Barry Manilow.
Just one voice singing in the darkness. All it takes is one voice singing so they hear what's on your mind, and when you look find there's more than one voice singing in the darkness. It takes that one voice.
Well, how's that for a teaser? Okay, well, not only is it a teaser, you know that that concert is coming up on January 22nd here at Lamb of God, and Giuliano will be joining Mark. But guess what's going to happen here next week? Just take a guess. Come on, folks. Who might be here next week? No, not Santa Claus. Mark Sanders is going to lead worship with Giuliana next Sunday. Yeah, so tell your friends. Make sure that we fill up the church here next week. In addition to that, we also need you to sell tickets, right? We have plenty of tickets for you to take with you today. And if everybody just sells 10, imagine the crowd that we will have over in the Vineyard on January 22nd. And as you all know, this is for an incredibly wonderful cause, the Children's Network. So we really want to sell as many as we can. So I'm thanking you in advance, and please stop at the desk on the way out and pick up some tickets. Also, today, we also have a wonderful concert happening here. At 4 o'clock, you can come and enjoy wine and cheese, and then the Singing Brooks are joining us at 4:30. It's going to be wonderful. So come on back this afternoon and enjoy this opportunity as well. How blessed we are to be able to enjoy these wonderful, wonderful singers. We also are having a food drive on this Wednesday from 9 until 12. You've seen the list in the newsletter of what they're looking for, but off the top of my head, I know baby food, canned vegetables, and bread are the top items that the food pantry needs. So please, 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 let's fill it up and give as much as we can. Also, on Wednesday, the Curb Your Appetite food truck is going to be joining us here from 4:30 until 6:30. Here's the kicker, though. We need you to sign up, because right now we need to get up to the number of 30 people for dinner, and we're not there yet. So if we don't have the 30, I think we're at 15, Val, is that what you said? Then we have to cancel it tomorrow. So if you're interested and you haven't done that yet, please sign up. Around the corner is Christmas Eve, and I don't know if we have a slide for that. We do. And as I said to you last week, try to imagine yourself immersed in Bethlehem on Christmas Eve, because that's what's going to happen. The whole Vineyard will be set with these beautiful slides that we will feel like we are in the city of Bethlehem and truly following the star that night. So please plan on joining us for that. And my final announcement this week is once again, within our nation, there has been a shooting in a school. And at some point, I know we are offering our prayers and our thoughts for those that have victims of this. There comes a point when action needs to be taken. And I'm not sure of the answer to that, but I hope that you will join me truly in listening hard to the sermon today as Lamb of God reaches out boldly, intentionally, and joyfully, because it's one thing to ask for prayers, but sometimes, folks, sometimes doing something means truly doing something, and doing nothing means that's what we're doing is nothing. So let's put our heads together and think about how we may be more involved here at Lamb of God. But do please keep the family and the victims and the community in your prayers. Those are all the announcements that I have this week. Let us begin to worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Stir up our hearts, Lord God, to prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, give to all the people of the world knowledge of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Malachi. See, I'm sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight, to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless. Having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. Word of God, word of life.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the third chapter. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip ruler of the reign of Iturea, and Trachonitis and Licinius ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, good morning again. So what I want to share with you is just a little bit about the organization of the lectionary, which is that book that provides us with all the readings for the year. And the reason we have a lectionary is that the powers that be felt that this was the only way that God's people would get exposed to the Word of God. So they put the lectionary together, they mark it A, B, and C, and this is the year of C, which is the year of Luke. But then they also do something else. What they do is put alternate readings in. And generally, those alternate readings aren't chosen because we don't follow a continuous pattern. But this week, after looking at the readings again more closely on Friday, I decided to use the alternate reading for my sermon, only you didn't get to hear the story. So you will hear it, though, this morning. And I just wanted to share that piece with you, and also to share with you that this particular week, which is the second Sunday of Advent for the Gospel of Luke, the theme is peace. So that Advent candle that we will light shortly, the kids will light, is about peace. And I don't know about you, but at this point in my life, I don't feel we have much peace. I'm just going to say that. Personal lives are one thing that we may all not have a lot of peace in right now. But personally and politically, I don't feel there's a lot of peace in our nation. And those are just my 2 cents worth, because I'm doing all this remembering. And the reason I'm doing all this remembering has to do with the readings for today, which are, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord." And that comes from Godspell. And the reason I always have this song in my head is because I actually had an opportunity when I was all of 14 years old to experience Godspell in the theater. Now, if you think I appreciated it at the age of 14, no. I had no idea what it was all about. My girlfriend's mother, who was like my second mom, decided she was taking these 13 and 14-year-old girls to see Godspell at the Schubert Theater in downtown Chicago. And so I was impressed with just that. But then we walk in and it starts, and I'm thinking, I'm going to get in trouble when I get home. When my parents really figure out what Martha took me to see, they're going to be furious. I mean, Jesus dressed as a hippie? Come on, folks, how outrageous was that in the year 1971? And they were all hippies on stage. I just want you to know that. And my parents did not like hippies at all. But here I am, the product of a Roman Catholic school education, listening to this music, and I loved it. I absolutely loved it, the bouncing around, the singing, and I thought, can church be like this? Wow, and it just kind of reminded me that we were beginning to do folk masses at my home church and how outrageous that was for the day. I bought the album, and I can't tell you how many times I listened to the whole Godspell album. But you know, I decided over the weekend that I really needed to look up a little bit more history about Godspell and understand the purpose of what was behind it. Why did the author write it? And what I learned should not have surprised me. It shouldn't surprise you either, but it did surprise me. It was written because during that time, he and a lot of other young people felt close to Jesus, but not close to the church. They saw Jesus in a different light. They did not want to see a Jesus that we venerated. They saw Jesus as their companion and their friend and someone they could relate to. And that the church, by the way, during that time was losing members. Go figure. The young people weren't going because they wanted more from the church than just having to do what some people in higher places thought was important. And as I read that, I thought, my goodness, what has changed? Nothing. And then to read the critics who wrote that all that these kids were doing was blasphemy, I thought, wow, that's pretty harsh. And that was 1971. And what again has changed? It broke my heart because you know what? It continues today. We continuously see here, let's get young people into the church. Just, well, hello. The church has to change. The church has to change, not the young people, but the people who are here right now have to change. And the question is, where does it begin? And so I chose a different reading for today, the continuous reading, which is the story of Zechariah. Now, what I'm disappointed in is that the church leaders who put this lectionary together tend to leave out probably the most important part of almost every biblical story that we hear every week. Somebody somewhere decided that we should only hear today the song of Zechariah, which is nice. But honestly, at the end of the day, it doesn't leave a very good message because it doesn't tell the whole message about Zechariah. How many of you know about Zechariah? We got one. Two. Yeah. That's what I thought. It's not your fault. It's not your fault. If you're going to tell the story about Christmas, let's hear the whole story of Zechariah, because this is about John the Baptist today. Not the grown-up John the Baptist, by the way, but the younger John the Baptist, that one that Elizabeth was carrying. You know who Elizabeth is, right? So here's the story of Zechariah. Zechariah was a high priest. He and Elizabeth were of the wealthy class of priests. Zechariah was extremely everybody liked him, highly respected. And it was Zechariah's turn to go into the temple and light the incense. It was an important part of the life of the synagogue, and it was his turn to stay there all night. And while Zechariah was there, angel Gabriel appeared to Zechariah. And the first thing he says to Zechariah is, "Do not be afraid." Well, Zechariah is terrified. Who wouldn't be a little fearful when an angel appears before you? But he says, "Don't be afraid. God has heard your prayer and Elizabeth's prayer, and you will have a son. And you and Elizabeth will name this son John." What does Zechariah do? It's like, are you kidding me? How is this going to happen? He says to Gabriel. And Gabriel just looks at him. He said, "Seriously? Do I not stand here before you as the presence of God? Do you not experience the presence of God? And right now you're going to ask me that question? How is this going to happen?" Well, it's happening because of God. And right now, Zechariah, you will not be able to speak any longer until this event happens in your life. So Zechariah walks out of the temple, and people are asking him all kinds of questions, and Zechariah can't talk. And people are saying, "What's going on here? He must have seen a vision." Well, he did. He saw a vision, and he went home. And people did not hear his voice until the time came for Elizabeth to bear them a son. In the meantime, Elizabeth is alerted that she is carrying this child, John. And she said, my God, look what you have done for me." She accepts it wholeheartedly. She knows what her responsibility is, and she waits until this child is to be born. And when it comes time for her to give birth, she gives birth to John, the baby John, and all the people, her family, surround her, and they say to her, "We are going to name this child Zechariah." And Elizabeth says, "No, we are not going to name this son Zechariah. On this day of his circumcision, his name will be John." And the people look to Zechariah, who, by the way, still can't speak. And they're like, tell us what we're supposed to do. And he's trying to sign to them. And eventually he takes a piece of paper and he writes out that this child's name, that we are naming him, is going to be John. And he has come to prepare the way of the Lord. And then Zechariah can speak. And Zechariah bursts into Zechariah's song about who this child is. But you see, this piece that he was singing and talking about was about what he and Elizabeth had done together. You see, it was both of them that brought this child into the world. Both of them talked about the good news of this child who has come at this time to prepare the way of the Lord for all of God's people. And that this child will lead them, and that this child will baptize. This is the child who will bring knowledge of God into the world. So here we are today on the second Sunday of Advent, celebrating the birth of this child who has come forth with the power of wisdom and the knowledge of God to bring peace on earth. And here we are today, where there is little peace right now, personally and politically. I've stood here with you now for probably, well, I know it's almost 4 years, and during that time, I honestly and shamefully don't know how many school shootings there have been. I know that there have been many, and I know that politically in our country, we're up in arms. We're fighting with one another about gun control. The abortion issue is now on the table at a new level. We are now continuing to face the COVID, and what does that mean as the press puts out more about another variant that's coming along? There's very little peace, at least in my soul at this point. And so when I hear that we're supposed to focus on peace today, and I think about the words of Godspell, and I think about the words of Zechariah, I have to wonder what this means to us. How do we live into this peace now that we have been blessed to know in our lives as Christian people? How do we move forward being the church here at Lamb of God? How do we do something instead of doing nothing? Because doing nothing is doing something, folks. And what can we do? Praying is important. But I also believe there is more that we can do. So in the way that God works, and God works in God's own way, I received an email from an organization, from Wendy, actually. And when it came to her mailbox, she sent it to me saying, "What do you think?" And I wanted to bury it. I don't want to deal with it. I don't like politics. Did I ever tell you that? I don't like talking about politics. I don't like ruffling feathers. It's much easier to walk the middle of the line. But I can't anymore, because doing nothing is doing something. So the organization that sent this is called Resetting the Table. Okay? Resetting the Table. And they're talking about The Color Purple, not the movie. Not the movie. So what two colors make purple? Blue and red. Might have a political connotation to it, right? A little bit. And do you have any idea what area in our country has a lot of blue and red in each of its states? Upper Midwest, yeah. Maybe like, yeah. So that's where Resetting the Table takes place. And this is an organization that set out to help people have a conversation and respecting one another. So they invited Republicans and Democrats, conservative and liberal, red and blue, to conversation in a barn in rural America. And they invited these people, and they had a facilitator to come in and have a conversation about all the things that are affecting us, and to have a conversation in which respecting each other's thoughts and listening to each other's thoughts could possibly bring people together, so that no longer were we separated by red and blue, but we became melded into purple. It's not about changing minds, folks. It's about listening. I watched the movie twice. And I'm going to tell you, this is what happened to me the first time around. Oh, no way. Not going to do that. Why would I bring that to Lamb of God? Put myself in that pot. Stir the pot up and just kind of get all nervous about it. Why would I do that? And then I watched it again, and the twitches got less. Because then I began to think about what it is we are supposed to do and what we can do. And what can start with us is conversation with one another. And not just us, but to invite other faith communities to join us, to present this video, to facilitate this video, and to begin the conversation. What could come out of it? Purple can come out of it. Conversation and doing something about what's happening in our country begins with us, because that will lead to something else and something else and something else. And Lamb of God, you've been telling me for 4 years, you are what? Open, boldly, intentionally, inclusive. So can we do it here? I think we can. And then I think once we do the first one, we'll do it again. And this time we're going to invite larger communities for the conversation. Because doing nothing is doing something. And I cannot stand up here and say, can we please pray for the next prayer shooting people if we don't do something? And this is the church. If you go back to God's spell, let's go back to what the original God's spell was about. It was about young people who saw a need to have Jesus as a companion in their lives, to prepare the way of the Lord. Isn't that what we should be doing? Preparing the way of the Lord? We don't have to be teenagers and hippies and wear the clothes. We have to live it though, right? So I'm just wondering if you're going to join me in resetting the table and becoming purple. Please, it's who you are, so let's do it. And let's prepare the way of the Lord. And let's do it with the energy and the excitement that you may have experienced in God's spell like this. Your next newsletter and the ones following for the date of the first showing, and you're going to be hearing more about it as we go forward, as we prepare the way of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Wait. straight path for God.
Wait for the Lord, whose day is near. Wait for the Lord, be strong, take heart.
Please stand. And together, let us pray the words of the Creed. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Malfunction here. In this season of watching and waiting, let us pray for all people and places that yearn for God's presence. O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is widening, grant peace and assurance. Where violence daunts and weakens our resolve, strengthen us. Where hopelessness overtakes seeking resolution, grant us resistance. Where the senseless death of innocence twists our thinking, show us the way. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Send your spirit to all living creatures that are endangered. Provide them with shelter and care, and bring us into right relationship with the earth that you create and call good. Hear us, O God. Send leaders to our nations, cities, schools, and businesses to work on behalf of those who have lost parents, spouses, and loved ones, immigrants, the imprisoned, those living in poverty, and all who are oppressed. Make them bold in their commitments to justice and reconciliation. Hear us, O God. Send your servants to care for those who suffer. Use our ministries and our lives to reach out with compassion to those who are hungry, oppressed, lonely, or ill, especially Ellie, John, Marion, Jerry, Jennifer, Lexi, Karen, Ron, Paul, Ann, Larry, Anthony, Pat, Jackie, Debbie, Glenn, Marcel, Doug, Sean, Barry, Father Al Pike, Lisa, Camilla, Kristen, Walter, Andrew, Jeremy, Nick, and Pam. Grant them healing and wholeness. Hear us, O God. Send prophets to speak difficult truths, even when they are poorly received. Embolden those who ask hard questions and challenge accepted ways. Instill in youth and elders alike a passion for pointing to Jesus in all things. Hear us, O God. God of new life, you come among us in the places we least expect. Receive these prayers and those of our hearts. In the name of Jesus,
amen. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to share that peace with one another. Let us pray. God of abundance, we bring before you the precious fruits of your creation, and with them, our very lives. Teach us patience and hope as we care for all those in need until the coming of our Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Yes. This is the way that our Lord has made. It is filled with peace and wisdom, righteousness and justice. Let us pray together with the words that he has given us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Taste and see that the Lord is good. This is the body of Christ given for you, and this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Stand. Let us pray. God, for whom we wait, in this meal you give us a foretaste of that day when the hungry will be fed with good things. Send us forth to make known your deeds and to proclaim the greatness of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. And remember the poor boldly, intentionally, and joyfully.